In this video, we'll talk about the amiodarone and the thyroid dysfunction related to it. Amiodarone is class 3 anti-arrhythmic drug. Its molecule has got two iodine molecules, so it accounts for about 39% of the iodine by weight, and due to this high content of the iodine and due to its intrinsic properties, amiodarone can cause thyroid related dysfunction. Now, talking about the mechanism of the amiodarone related thyroid dysfunction, we can classify the mechanism into two types, either due to intrinsic drug effects or due to the effect of the iodine. Amiodarone, it inhibits the monodeiodination of the T4, so there will be the decreased production of the T3. And similarly, amiodarone also blocks the T3 receptor binding to the nuclear receptors, and that will lead to the decrease in the expression of the thyroid hormone related genes. And amiodarone can also directly affect the thyroid follicular cells, leading to the destructive thyroiditis. Due to the effect of the iodine, the patient can have the thyroid dysfunction due to Wolff cycle effect, in which a patient will present with the hypothyroidism, or patient can also have the hyperthyroidism due to the Jort-Basedow phenomenon. So what are the effects of amiodarone on thyroid function? It can cause acute transient suppression of the thyroid function. It can cause hypothyroidism. It can cause hyperthyroidism. We'll talk about each of them briefly. So talking about the transient suppression of thyroid function, this occurs because of the Wolff cycle effect, that is iodine dependent suppression of the thyroid function. And these patients will present with the decrease in the T4 level after starting the amiodarone. And when the amiodarone is used for some longer duration, their patient will escape from the Wolff cycle effect, and the following hormonal effects will be seen. The T4, which was initially low, starts to increase, and RT3 increases, TSS increases, however T3 will remain low. This is because of the inhibitory effects on the deiodinase activity and thyroid hormone receptor action of amiodarone. And after using amiodarone for the 3 to 6 months, TSS will come back to its normal level. T4 and RT3 level will be slightly elevated or in the upper normal level, and T3 level will be in the low normal level. So let's talk about amiodarone induced hypothyroidism. It is due to the inability of the thyroid cells to escape from the Wolff cycle effect, and it is common in the iodine sufficient areas, and it is more common in those patients with underlying Hashimoto thyroiditis and who have positive anti-thyroid antibodies. It is diagnosed based on the low or low normal T4 and raised TSH. And during the treatment, it is not necessary to stop the amiodarone, and it should be treated by supplementing thyroxin hormone. So the next is hyperthyroidism, or amiodarone-induced thyrotoxicosis, AIT. It is classified into two types, type 1 and type 2. And these type 1 and type 2 differ in the various ways. We'll talk about those differences. In type 1, there is increased synthesis of the T3 and T4 due to the Jort-Basedow phenomenon, whereas in type 2, there is increased release of the T3 and T4 due to the destructive thyroiditis. In type 1, it occurs in those patients with pre-existing multinodular goiter or latent Graves' disease, whereas type 2 occurs in those without any underlying thyroid disease. Similarly, type 1 occurs early after the initiation of the amiodarone, whereas type 2 occurs much later after the initiation of the amiodarone. Also, they can be differentiated by using the color doppler sonography. In type 1, there is increased vascularity, whereas in type 2, there is absent vascularity. So now let's talk about the treatment of the AIT. So should we stop or continue the amiodarone? Amiodarone might have been given for the life-threatening arrhythmias, and even if we stop it, there is no immediate effect due to its long half-life. And amiodarone itself has shown to decrease the features of hyperthyroidism by blocking T4 to T3 conversion, beta adrenergic receptors, and T3 receptors. So most of the guidelines, they suggest that we continue with the amiodarone and treat the AIT. So now let's talk about the treatment of the type 1 and type 2 AIT. Type 1 AIT should be treated with the thionamides, and they are usually required in the larger than the usual doses. Next is the perchlorate. It blocks the further uptake of the iodine by the thyroid gland, so it's somewhat beneficial. And the lithium has also got some benefit, and beta blockers and iopinic acid, they block the T4 to T3 conversion and are useful. Similarly, radioiodine can be used if the uptake is high enough, and the surgery, it is reserved for those who are refractory to the antithyroid drug therapy. And for the treatment of the type 2 AIT, glucocorticoids are the mainstay of the treatment, and they are used in the moderately larger doses. And next is the iopinic acid. It has got some benefit in the type 2 AIT. However, perchlorate, which is commonly used in type 1, has no benefit in type 2. And the surgery, it is reserved for those who are refractory to the steroids. Let's discuss how to monitor TFT. TFT should be done in every patient before starting the amiodarone. It should be repeated every 3 to 4 months during the treatment, and at least 1 year after stopping amiodarone. And in other patients, it should be individualized based on the status of the patient.